Thank you for giving me this opportunity. It's a pleasure for me presenting to you this really preliminary draft. And by the way, I changed my presentation also thanks to the wonderful presentations of the guys yesterday that a bit let me understood which kind of presentation should I do. And so I start with a picture, if it works. Oh, sorry. Okay. I start with a picture that represents the really simple idea behind this paper. And the idea is that I have a datum of the problem that is an objective preference relation that is incomplete. And I have this decision maker that faces a problem. I have to complete this incomplete preference relation. So imagine me as the decision maker. I go to Professor Maccheroni, that for me represents theory, and I ask him, how should I complete this preference relation? And he says, look, there are several n, in this example, three, potential completion criteria, and there read just maximin under GS, and under IB, then I will explain you what it is. It's invariant V-separable preference, but it's not important. What is important is that there are two different ways of completing the objective preference relation. When I mean objective, it means that I have a proof. So if you ask me why should I prefer F toward G objectively, if Squiggle star says me something, I have a proof, and so I can show you and I convince you that indeed it's right to prefer F over G. Then, if Squiggle star doesn't say me anything at all, then I imagine that I compare other two acts, like H and K, and I cannot objectively prefer H toward K, but I can prefer H toward K if I use, for instance, Squiggle 1. In that case, I don't have a proof, but you don't have a proof to show me that I'm wrong in preferring H toward K. Now, of course, it represents the theory, and it shows me several potential completion criteria, but somehow I have to do my choices, so I have to implement. And I have an attitude toward this potential criteria that influences the way in which I aggregate them in the finally chosen choice correspondence. Okay, just a bit of historical background. So this morning was presented the Ellsberg paradox. It's a really important paradox, and one young guy, together with his advisor, Gilboa, and Smidler was the advisor, proposed a really intelligent way of somehow solving axiomatically the problem that mainly he decided to weaken an independence assumption, adding an important axiom that was uncertainty aversion, and arriving to a maximin representation. This paper, Gilboa, Maccheroni, Marinacci, Smidler, 2010, it's a really interesting one because they find a different way in funding the Gilboa Smidler representation, because they find a way in which the objective incomplete preference relation that has a Boolean representation, then we will see what Boolean means, but at this point you have to imagine that you have this incomplete preference relation, Squiggle star, and Squiggle hat that is complete, it is Gilboa Smidler, and they find a bridge between these two preferences relations that is mainly based on one axiom whose name is Cocius. Then there is another paper that is tightly related with what I'm going to present to you today, and is this paper by Kress, Gilboa, and VL 2011. It's a JET paper in which they have the problem of a decision maker that has to take a decision in a context of uncertainty, and he doesn't know how to take this decision, and he asks the opinion of several experts. These experts, of course, in providing their advice, they are all maximin guys, and they provide their advice by using, and this they have to impose, by the way, by using the same utility function of the decision maker, because, of course, our advice is tailored to that particular decision maker. And the decision maker has a pessimistic attitude toward experts' opinion, and he aggregates them in a finally implemented squiggle relation that it will be how the decision maker takes his decision at the end. And then this, the last paper is the paper just mentioned by So that is important for what I'm planning to do and what I'm doing in the, these few weeks, but it's still not closed. If I will have time at the end, I will tell you which is the main idea, but okay. This goes back and to go. Okay. So, Ascombe-Aumann setup, 1963. This is the restatement provided by Fishburne in 1970. And we have a set of lotteries over a set of outcomes, acts. There is a set of states endowed with an algebra. In this case, imagine even a finite number of states and the power set. And of course, there is the simplex over the elements of this algebra, and there is a set of acts, as was explained to you by Professor Maccheroni yesterday. And what an act is a simple measurable map from the set of states to the set of lotteries. Inside this general set of acts, we like to focus our attention on some particular acts that are the constant acts. The constant act can be easily identified with one particular lottery because whatever the states, it associates always the same lottery to that particular state. And then there is the domain and the range of our finally implemented choice correspondence that represent the choices that will be eventually made. And this calligraphic I, that is the set that contains all the subset of acts. And as I said, there is squiggle star, the objective preference relation, and several n, important that n is finite, potential completion criteria. Okay, what a Boolean preference relation is an incomplete preference relation that satisfies reflexivity, transitivity, non-degeneracy, monotonicity. It means that if an act F dominates state by state another act G, it's reasonable to assume that F is preferred over G, a technical assumption about continuity. C completeness says that you are able to compare all the constant acts, and independence says you that morally, if you prefer F toward G, you don't have a reverse ranking when you consider all the convex combination of F with a generic act H, important that the weights of in which you combine F and H and G and H are the same. Yes? What do you mean? No, and there is the degeneracy condition. It's a non-triviality condition exactly for your reason. And then we have the invariant bisepolo, the same set of axioms as before. Just notice that here we have a straightening of completeness. So from C completeness, we go to completeness, but we have a weakening of independence. Okay, of course I have to say something about also the choice correspondence. So the idea is that to each choice correspondence, I can associate a revealed preference associated to the choice correspondence. Now, I call my choice correspondence invariant biseparable exactly because I want that the revealed preference associated to the choice correspondence is an invariant biseparable preference. Perfect, but so by the lecture of Professor Maccheroni yesterday, I know that the weak axiom, a revealed preference, buy for me reflexivity, completeness, and transitivity. So what I have to do is to translate the other axiom in the language of the choice correspondence. Okay, now what, yeah.
Can you clarify how exactly are they incomplete? Can you clarify how exactly are they incomplete? So one slide back.
This means that, if you consider the constant act, you can fully compare it. But
which axiom?
Look, see completeness. What I'm imposing is simply that I'm able to compare all the acts that are constant. But it's not necessarily I will be able to compare all the other acts. Maybe there are two acts about which I cannot decide.
And non-degeneracy?
The non-degeneracy simple say that there are two acts.
But it is implied by C completeness.
No? It's not, no.
Okay.
And now the point is this. What is reasonable? It's reasonable that I will find a set of axioms to let this preference relation talks. Of course, I want this potential completion criteria talk with the objective preference relation. And they want the choice correspondent to talk with the potential completion criteria, hopefully in an intelligent way, in such a way I will preserve, for instance, consistency. But now I will go in details. So what I mean for consistency? A preference relation, and this is, by the way, consistency caution. Caution is the key axiom of that paper, GMMS 2010. I can say that without that axiom, would not be so successful, that paper. And cautiousness, it implies uncertainty aversion. So they find a way to refund, because they don't use uncertainty aversion, they use caution for funding, again, the Gilboa-Smather representation. So what consistency says that simply, if squiggle star says me that I have to prefer F toward G, given that squiggle star is a primitive on my decision maker, it's reasonable that also the N potential completion criteria that I'm considering will prefer F toward G. Caution says that somehow you have to imagine, no, a generic act as, let me say, two different type of uncertainties. The one that is embedded inside the lottery, right? And the other one, the fact that you are considering several lotteries for each state, right? The constant act has 1 degree less of uncertainty, right? Because it's simply the uncertainty embedded inside the lottery. And that's why I can define my decision maker caution if, when the objective preference relation doesn't say me prefer F over G, but G is a constant act, then it's reasonable that the potential completion criteria, if it's caution, will prefer G toward F. Now I will try to let the choice correspondence somehow talk with the N potential completion criteria, so I'm below in the graph, and I'm trying to let talk this N preference relation with the choice correspondence. And I will present you three axioms. I will not impose in the lemma that you will see later all them together, in particular because the third one implies, for instance, consistency toward criteria. Consistency toward criteria says if all the N potential completion criteria agrees, of course, the choice correspondence has to agree with them. At the end, it's an aggregation. Caution toward criteria describe a really caution decision maker that says, look, when I compare two acts, F toward G, and G is constant, and at least one of the N potential completion criteria doesn't prefer F toward G, then I'm really cautious, and I prefer G toward F, okay? Finally, and here I need a bit more of notation, I need to define what a certainty equivalent is. So a certainty equivalent to a generic act F related to a specific preferred relation I is a constant act that is indifferent to F. And yes, it exists under this assumption that about invariant separable preferences and so on is another paper by theirs in which they show this. And I have a translation of the concept of certainty equivalent in the language of choice correspondence. And I define criterion certainty aversion. So for the mathematicians, criterion certainty aversion buys for us concavity of the function that will represent these preferences. For the economist, it represent a pessimistic behavior, and you will see when you will see the functional representation that is really similar but with different interpretation and different over different things to the one of Gilboa-Smather, will represent a pessimistic behavior toward this N potential completion criteria, in the meaning that I trust Professor Maccheroni, but, you know, in the life you never know. So, like... but let's say what this axiom says to us. It says take an act F, you take several acts Fj with j that goes from 1 to capital J, and you take a fixed set of weights, all positive and all the sum up to 1, so you see probability, you can give an interpretation in terms of probability, and if all the potential completion criteria prefer F toward the convex combination of the certainty equivalence associated to that act and to that particular preference relation. Notice that the alpha j are always the same, okay? They don't depend in no way to the preference relation that I'm considering. Then the choice corresponds has to do the same, has to be consistent. Okay, So I will not show you the proof, even a sketch of the proof. There is, but it's not important. What is important for me, okay, for the not decision maker, a Boolean preference relation normally has this kind of representation, right? It arises naturally a set of priors and says prefer F toward G if and only if all the set of priors agrees on what you have to do. Invariant separable preferences, and this is a result that is contained in Girardato, Maccheroni, Marinacci 2004, it's a JET paper, have this kind of functional representation where the functional is particularly nice because it's monotone and constant additive and positively homogeneous. And this is important for the proof, but has some nice properties. And then, of course, the choice correspondence has an associated revealed preference that, of course, squiggle star is abelian. And then potential completion criteria and the choice correspondence are invariant separable. I impose consistency of the n potential completion criteria with the objective preference relation, and I impose on C naught that satisfy in this moment only criteria uncertainty aversion. If you remember, criteria uncertainty aversion implies consistency toward criteria. Okay, what is interesting in this lemma is that I have a functional representation that naturally arises from the fact that I have a revealed preference relation associated to the choice correspondent that is invariant separable. But at the same time, by using a particular argument, I'm able to show you that naturally realize a set, gamma, that is closed and convex. So the minimum is well defined. Where he lives, gamma? He lives in the simplex over the n potential completion criteria, and is the minimum over the convex combinations of the functional, convex combination taken in the set gamma. Okay? I will explain you why this representation, this is the proof. It's not important what I like. I don't know even why, but I like it. It's the point that given that I have consistency of the choice correspondence with the n potential completion criteria, of course, the n potential completion criteria are consistent with the objective preference relation. And this way, the choice correspondence is consistent with the objective preference relation. And this allow me to, given that the utility function associated to each one of these preference relations are all affine transformation of the same function, I can normalize them and use one utility function. But this is pretty reasonable because the decision maker is one at the end. So I don't need to impose that I go to the experts and they have to use my utility function. Naturally arise from the setup. And then there is several extension that starts from the convex range and arrive to up to Rn to preserve full dimensionality. This functional, it's nice because once you arrive to the convex hull and then to Rn is also concave, you can apply a really simple supporting hyperreal theorem and you have really, this is the Gilboa-Smither argumentation, by the way, it's super standard in the literature. Okay, corollary. In this setup, if one of the potential completion criteria is cautious, okay, I end up exactly in the same type of representation as Gilboa-Smither 2010, and the answer is, in general, no. When I end up there? I end up only if I'm facing a super cautious decision maker that considers the possibility, contemplates the possibility to give probability one to this cautious potential completion criteria. In that case, I collapse in this type of representation, but naturally that set gamma doesn't contemplate the fact that there is this canonical vector of Rn with probability one to the cautious potential completion criteria. Okay, so now the answer is, but how much cautious this decision maker has to be in order to end up and to collapse in a representation a la GMMS 2010, and the answer is really cautious. In fact, it has to satisfy consistency toward criteria. Now I have to impose, because uncertainty toward criteria doesn't imply, I'm not imposing any more uncertainty toward criteria, so it doesn't imply any more consistency toward criteria. And I have to impose consistency toward criteria and caution toward criteria. And under that assumption, I end up exactly in the same representation a la Gilboa GMMS 2010. Okay, just to conclude, I hope that is in framework it's easier to analyze the mental aggregation process that lead to some particular choices that indeed will be implemented. I was able to show that in general, we don't end up in a representation like the one in GMMS 2010. We end up there only if the decision maker is really cautious. And what I would like to do is to give to axiomatically to the revealed preference associated to the choice correspondence a particular functional shape for the technical people an eviloid in such a way that they can use an argumentation similar to the one provided by Tommaso, so a variational type of argumentation. And in this case, naturally, it would arise naturally a cost function that has this type of interpretation. The interpretation is the following. Professor Maccheroni proposed me several potential completion criteria, but of course, some of these criteria for me could be more natural, so I could be naturally biased towards some of these criteria. And of course, the criteria for, that are easier for me to implement, I will have a lower cost, and the criteria that will be harder for me to implement will have a higher cost. I conclude. Thank you so much for the attention.
Thank you, Francesco. Are there questions?
Yeah. I would like to understand a basic fact, which is the following. So, do you suppose that these completion criteria are given, and you want to choose one?
Yes, or you want primitive. To,
that's
primitive.
They are primitive.
Are primitive on my problem. Sorry if I was not clear, but you have as primitive of this problem, you have to consider squiggle star, then potential completion criteria, and C naught. That are primitives.
The whole idea is to choose one completion criteria.
Not one. The idea is to aggregate them in a particular way that they will represent the choices that indeed will be implemented. So the choice correspondence, the revealed preference associated to the choice correspondence. Look that, for instance, to how to go back. This representation, this one, doesn't mean that you are choosing necessarily one. You are considering convex combination of the functionals that represents then potential completion criteria. So it's really an aggregation and not necessarily trivial, like the one that you might.
Can you go to the...
back or...?
Well, I guess forward, but what we had before. I was just trying to understand the bias thing because the most you know the thing that really someone like me noticed first is the weight gamma j, right? And you're talking about biases toward different criteria.
Yes.
And so to me, the first thing that comes to mind in order to talk about the bias, you know, is the weight. But of course, then you have the minimizations with respect to weights. So I just wanted to have some more clarification about what you mean by bias, that, you know, the role of weights and cost.
Maybe,
and
I don't know if I used an improper term in economics, but my point is that, of course, if let's imagine a canonical vector, so that gives probability one to the potential completion criteria one, okay? If that has cost zero, for me, it means that that is a natural criteria for me. If that has a cost different from zero, in that case, it means that it's not natural for me to use that potential completion criteria. And then I consider, of course, combination of the potential completion criteria, and if they have exactly the same thing. If they have a high cost, it means that this combination is less natural for me to implement. If they have a low cost, it's not. This is So maybe it's not a bias, like.
Okay, no, I was not objecting to the word bias. I was just trying to understand what the bias is about.
Okay.
And so the bias is related to the weight vectors, not to the criteria themselves, because the.
Understand? You know, yes, I understand. Yes, you are right.
Just a clarification question. So in this setup, you are working with choice correspondents in your completion. Is there a corresponding preference relation?
Yes, I know that. I mean, yes. But the point is that in the choice setting, it's more natural to think about choice correspondents as the finally implemented one, but I don't have a particular benefit of working with a choice correspondents. I could work with a preference relation, that is the aggregation of the one and potential completion criteria. It would not change anything for me. Like, it's only, really, in fact, I mean, I can do Gilbo, GMMS 2010 paper, adding this choice correspondent.
Yes, quick. So would it make sense to relax the C completeness assumption and consider an incomplete preference relation also on certain acts? Because now you're assuming that certain acts can be are completely ranked.
It's me, because normally C completeness, you like it, because in the proofs, you can find a utility function, no? That you can use a sort of a Neumann-Morgenstern argument, and so it naturally allows a utility function. If you relax C completeness, I don't know how to treat it mathematically. I mean, maybe it has sense, but.
Completeness on tastes and beliefs is something people have been after for a long time, and up to now I would say that there are no good results. Of course, it would be fantastico.
I think we should thank Francesco.